mountain can't be moved. They say these chains will never break, but they don't know you like we do. There is power in your name. We've heard that there is no way through. We've heard the tide will never change. They haven't seen what you can do. There is power in your name. So much power in your name. Move the immovable, break the unbreakable. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. From the impossible, we'll see a miracle. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. We know that hope is never lost. Oh, for there is still an empty grave. God, we believe no matter what. There is power in your name. So much power in your name.
They say this mountain can't be moved.
Is that what they say?
They say these chains will never break.
Do you believe that?
But they don't know you like we do.
That's right, hallelujah.
There is power in your name. We've heard that there is no way through. We've heard the tide will never can do. There is power in your name. So much power in your name. Move the immovable. Break the unbreakable. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. From the impossible, we'll see a miracle. God, we believe. God, we believe for it.
Hallelujah, Lord, I believe.
We know that hope is never lost. Oh, for there is still an empty grave. God, we believe no matter what. There is power in your name. So much power in your name. Move the immovable. Break the unbreakable. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. From the impossible, we'll see a miracle. God, we believe. God, we believe.
Praise the Lord. Do you believe for it today? Hallelujah. He is faithful, His promise. So good to see you in the house of the Lord today. God's goodness and His mercy. Thankful that we're able to come and to gather on this Easter Sunday morning. What a mighty God we serve today. He's faithful. Faithful His promise. And I'm thankful to be in His house today. So glad that you chose to be with us today, all of our guests. If you're a first-time guest, we invite you to fill out a guest card you'll find in the back of the pew and just drop it in the offering plate when it comes by. Later, we'd love to connect with you later, follow up with you, and just believing that God is going to touch hearts and lives today throughout the land, throughout the world today. There's been Easter sunrise services. There's special emphasis placed on Easter Sunday. As I shared with our congregation last week, for us as the church, every Sunday is really Easter Sunday. We celebrate His resurrection every Sunday, and I am thankful to know that my Lord is risen. A friend of mine texted me this morning, he put on there, "He is risen," and my response to him was, "He is risen indeed." I'm glad to know that my Savior lives today, and so thankful once again for you choosing to be in the house of the Lord with us today. And let's just stand, invite the Lord to have His way on the remaining part of this service this morning, and believing that He's going to touch and minister and move in our midst today. He is here to meet every need, to supply every need, and He's faithful as promised. Father God, we love You today. We thank You for the privilege that we have to be here this morning, and we just gather to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We believe for it, God. We believe You for miracles. We believe You for wonders. We believe You to touch and minister in hearts and lives, minds and souls, and we just put our confidence in You today to know that You are faithful as promised. Have Your way in the remaining part of this service, and we'll give You praise, honor, and glory for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Remain standing with me, and let's sing this song together. It says, He lives. I need lots of help on this song because it goes real high, and I can't get that high sometimes. So just worship together. Today. And because He lives, we can face anything. Because He lives, we can carry on. Let's sing this next song together. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow.
He lived and died.
feel that way this morning, that your life is worth the living because He lives, just lift your hands and give Him praise. Scripture to all Christians, and maybe even some that don't even attend church. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. You know what that means? Because He lives, all of us can face tomorrow. I don't know what tomorrow holds. I don't know what we're going to go through and what we're going to face. But I'm glad I know who holds my tomorrow.
He is faithful, as promised. Can we just lift our hands and praise Him for that today? Thank Him that He is in control of our tomorrow. Father, we just thank You and praise You, glorify You, to know that because we serve a risen Savior, we serve the living God, that we can live throughout the ages, Lord, and knowing, God, that we're going to live forever. So we put our trust in You as we're born again believers, and we just thank You for that today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. One of our ushers to come at this time, give you an opportunity to give today, tithe and offering. Give is given unto the Lord, and I know it'll be a blessing. It'll definitely be a blessing to the church, but did you know when you give, it's a blessing to you as well? I found out a long time ago that 90% goes a lot further than 100%. It does not make sense mathematically, and you may say, you don't know anything about math, Pastor, if you say that. Well, I scored on the SATs in 7th grade, top 98 percentile in the nation in math. So I know a little bit about math. And I know this, that God's math is so much better than ours. Because I have found out that when I take that tenth off the top and place it in, that God has made a way so many times. He's been faithful. And then giving a good love offering, He's a good measure, pressed down, overflowing, will men give into your bosom. And I'm just believing that. I'm believing God for His word. I don't give to get, but I know that God will bless, and He loves for us to be a cheerful giver. And there's so much to be thankful for, so much that God is blessing us with. We have some business things going on within our church right now. So let's just pray for those areas. Nothing that we're struggling financially, just some negotiations and dealings that we're dealing with that we need God just to move in, and some legal matters to be taken care of, some I's to be dotted and T's to be crossed. But it's no big deal, especially to God. It's just kind of annoying to me as a pastor dealing with that administrative side of it. So pray, Lord, give us wisdom as we navigate through these things as we receive our offering today. And I'm still believing, have faith believing. A couple people's laughed at me, but I'm praying the Lord make a way that this property will be given to us. And I know God is faithful to do that. I know that He is able to do that. And I don't need the Baptists just to give it to us if they're not willing to do that, and I can understand that. God knows more millionaires than I do. All I need is a million. And God can do that as well. So however the Lord wants to do it, I believe He brought us here, and He put us here and placed us here. And I believe He's going to do great things here for us. So be praying along those lines. And if you don't believe that, and you don't believe that God can do that, I need you to have faith believing that He is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think or imagine. God is faithful, as promised. So you give today as giving unto the Lord. It's amazing these last few years. COVID has just caused people to leave the church and not come back. But God has taken and He's blessed financially, and I'm thankful for that. Don't forget, next Sunday night, church, 5 o'clock, we'll have our quarterly business meeting, our first quarterly business meeting of this year. And got good reports to bring to you of the goodness of God financially, how He's blessed. So thankful for your stewardship and your continued giving that we're able to do that. So you give today as giving unto the Lord, and I know it'll be a blessing. Father, we're grateful for each one of our friends and family that have gathered with us today to worship You here in house and online as well. And we just pray, Heavenly Father, that You would just let Your anointing be upon this part of the service as we give and tithe and offering. And knowing, Lord God, that You'll bless the gift and the giver alike, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you as you give. appreciate your giving today. Appreciate your faithfulness in giving and your goodness to the work of the Lord. So thankful for that. Brother Mike and Sister Diane is coming around to sing, and I'm trying to find Sister Diane a mic. Figure on Easter Sunday everything will get technical issues, but we'll figure it out. But they're coming to sing, and usually I don't appoint songs to people to sing and ask them to sing anything in particular. Not as pastor, and in my new role here this year, serving as music director, I don't even do it in that aspect. But here a few weeks ago, I asked Brother Mike if him and Sister Diane would do this song. Gracie and I have done it together, and Gracie did a beautiful job, me not so much. Sister Mary and I did it together. Sister Mary did a beautiful job, me not so much. But I just, when I heard this song, when I think of this song, and I love these two, their voices. I love to hear them sing. Not talking about the ones that originated these songs, but Brother and Sister Knobloch. I appreciate their voices and their vocals. And I just asked Brother Mike, I said, can y'all try this and see if, just listen to it and see if you can. They never came back and said they couldn't. And they didn't balk. They didn't complain. At least to me, they didn't. They may have, while they were practicing, I don't know. Is it that pastor? I don't know. But I just believe that the Lord's going to speak to our hearts this morning. So listen to the words. This is a conversation. This song is a conversation between Mary and Jesus. And just think about the message that's coming forth in this song. So worship with them as they sing.
He knows this is my side. I hope y'all enjoy this. It was actually a pretty easy ask. Some songs we struggle with, but this one was right in our key. So it has a beautiful message. I hope y'all enjoy it.
All of this is exactly how it's supposed to be.
I'm right here. Can you hear my voice? My life, my love, my Lord, my baby boy.
As they nail me to this tree, just know the Father makes me.
God, how can this be your will, to have your son and my son killed?
Whatever happens, whatever you see, whatever your eyes tell you has become of me, this is not, it's not the end. I am making all things new again. As they nail me to this tree, just know the Father waits for me.
God, how can this be your will,
see.
I don't want to see.
Whatever your eyes tell you has become of me. This is not.
No, it's not.
It's not the end. I am making all things new again. Whatever
happened,
whatever you see,
don't wanna see,
whatever your eyes tell you has become of me, this is not,
no, it's
not the end, I am making all things new.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Aren't you thankful that he's making all things new again? As he hung there upon that cross, Jesus said, "It is finished." And I think there's been some confusion along the years of what he meant by that. When he said, "It is finished," he meant that his task, that he had fulfilled his part of what he was supposed to do. But when he said, "It is finished," that was just the beginning for you and me. I'm so glad that that's not how the story ends. We each teach this in children's church and Sunday school, a little song that they would teach them as they hung him high. They stretched him wide. He bowed his head. For me, he died. That's love. That's love. To know this isn't how the story ends, but 3 days later, he rose again. That's love. Aren't you thankful for the love of God? Thankful for the love of God. Thank you, Brother Mike, Sister Diane. And I knew it was right in y'all's wheelhouse because I'm musically inclined that way. That's why I'm the music director, you know. I don't know anything about music. I love the Lord, though. I love to sing. Whether people want to hear me sing or not, I love to sing. I love the words to songs. I love preaching. I'm a preacher, and I love good preaching, and I'm inspired by preaching. But a well-written, anointed song speaks volumes to me. And I just, sometimes I can't even hear the music, Sister Gilda. I just hear the words of what's going on, the story that's being told. And what a story. I just, for that song, every time I hear it, I can just, the first time I heard it was in a passion play. So it was a woman that was dressed as Mary and a man that was dressed as Joseph or as Jesus. And they were standing there singing that, and it was just powerful. And so I picture that in my mind when I hear that song, that conversation. We don't think about the conversations that could have taken place during that time. But I am so thankful that he went all the way our sins to atone. I'm thankful for that. Once again, it's good to have you in the house of the Lord today. Good to have you here in-house and those that may be listening in on Spreaker online. Good to have you in service with us as well. Now turn with me to Matthew chapter 27. Over the last several weeks, and then one more service after tonight, or this morning, there will be no p.m. service tonight, by the way, no p.m. service, but Wednesday night we'll conclude this series of messages on the doors of the Bible. And you say, man, I came on Easter Sunday in the middle of a series. Don't worry, it's not one of those type series that one ties to the other. We've just been going through each door, different doors of the Bible. And this morning I want to talk to you fittingly about the tomb's door. We read in Matthew chapter 27, and verse number 59. Most humbling story in the Word of God. I remember years ago pastoring in Oklahoma, a guy next door to the church just moved in, and we had Thursday morning prayer meeting, the men did, and he came in to one of those prayer meetings, and he walked down the aisle and wanted to talk to the pastor. So I met him there, and as we met there around the altar section, he told me, he introduced himself as Bob and just moved in next door. And I asked him, I said, Bob, are you saved? He said, I don't know.
I said, then you're not. And I said, but that can change right now. And I led Bob to the Lord that day, right there on a Thursday morning in the church around the altar. Led him to the Lord. And I would often see Bob as I'd come up church. Anytime anybody, Brother Kevin, would pull up to the church, Bob would come running over there. Ladies would be there for a ladies' ministries meeting or anything, a birthday party. We've had families come in and use the building for Christmas Eve. Bob would come over there. He thought the doors were open. I'm going to be in church. And didn't realize that not everything was open for that. It was not a church service, but Bob would do that. But when he wasn't running over there for church, he was not able to work. So he just sat out there on a couch outside of his house. And I would see him many times when I would come to the church, or I would ride by, and he'd be sitting there on that couch reading his Bible. He came to me, Sister Gilda, one service, and he said, pray for me, Pastor. I said, what's up, Bob? He said, I know. He said, I went to church when I was little and younger, and I know that I am just about to that place. I said, what place? He said, I'm reading my Bible, and I'm just about to that place where Jesus goes to the cross. He said, I don't know if I can handle reading that. And tears began to stream down his face just standing there talking to me about that. And I remember, I immediately thought back to years ago. I preached the message, 10 Steps to Calvary. And I preached in detail the steps that went to Calvary. And there was every eye in the house was dry. Seasoned Christians, it seemed like that did not affect them whatsoever. But for Bob, just the very thought that I'm about to read the Passion, tears began to well up in his eyes. And he said, I don't know that how they beat him and how that he hung on that cross. He said, I don't know if I can handle reading that. I said, well, Bob, when you get to it, just remember that he did every bit of that for you and for me. And if we were the only one, he would have still done it. And what happened to you on that Thursday morning standing here in the altar of this church, that's why he paid that price. Aren't you thankful for that this morning? But I'm also thankful to know that he's not hanging on that cross. He's not laying in a grave, but he is risen. We serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. And because he lives, I can face tomorrow. And I know that he is making all things new again. Just tying all the songs in today, I believe for it. Amen. Matthew 27, verse 59. And when Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn out in the rock. And he rolled a great stone to the door of the sepulchre and departed. Heavenly Father, I'm thankful for the price that was paid for us on that day. So many years ago, oh God, we have to recall in the resurrection story, we have to recall the crucifixion. We have to recall the beating. We have to recall the death, the pain and the agony and the darkness of that day. Oh, Lamb of God, we know that it happened. We know that it's not just something that's a myth or a legend, but we know that was a price that was paid for us as we covered Wednesday night that Jesus was our Passover Lamb, and we're thankful for that. Lord, we're here today to celebrate Resurrection Morn, and we're just so thankful, Lord, that as we recall that, we know the reality that there had to be a death in order for there to be a resurrection. And we're thankful that Jesus overcame the tomb door. And we're just thankful for what's going to be accomplished here in the house of the Lord today. As you anoint me to preach and anoint hearts to receive, we'll praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated today. Matthew Henry said this about these verses. He said, a great stone was rolled to the door of the sepulcher. This also was according to the custom of the Jews in burying their dead, as appears by the description of the grave of Lazarus found in John 11 and 38, signifying that those who are dead are separated and cut off from all the living. So if the grave were his prison, now was the prison door locked and bolted. The rolling of the stone to the grave's mouth was with them, as filling up the grave is with us, is completed. It completed the funeral. Matthew Henry lets us know there that if that grave was the prison, then the prison door was bolted. We don't understand the rolling the stone to the door. That's not how we do it. But we do understand at the end of a funeral service, the funeral director will step up and say, this concludes our service today. In just a few moments, we're going to lower this casket into the ground. Family is welcome to stay.
But what we're going to do is we're going to cover this casket. We're going to bury this hole. I have been in services where there was a shovel there that some of the family members would come by and take a shovel full or drop a rose or what have you in that. But we understand, we call that the committal service. And so that committal that took place, it was finished, it's done. He was dead, it is final. We know that when that takes place, that is the end of that life. They're no longer living. I remember doing nursing home ministry years ago, and Mother Ruiz used to ask her, how you're doing? Come in there. She was a blind lady who had ended up in a nursing home that her husband and herself evangelized for many years. And she had to be craned out of her bed, she was blind, life was difficult for her. But you wouldn't know that in talking to her. I would visit her on Saturdays just to glean from her and to hear her stories of what God did in their ministry over the years. But this is usually how the conversation would go when you see her. When you walk in the room, I'd say, Mother, how are you doing today? She said, it's good to be alive and among the living. It's good to be alive and among the living. I said, well, amen. It is good to be alive and among the living. And you know what Jesus did? He came to be alive and to be amongst the living. He spent that 33 and a half years of that, but at this moment, he was not alive. He was dead. He laid there in that tomb for those days. Those 3 days as he laid there, they said, it's finished. There was a crowd that gathered to saw what took place, and it was finished. They saw as he breathed his last breath. They heard him as he said, it's finished. They maybe even watched as Joseph and Nicodemus took him down off that cross, wrapped him in those garments, placed him in that tomb, watched as the soldiers rolled the stone to the door, and it was definitely a funeral there that day. It was the conclusion, and it was finished, and all hell, no doubt, was rejoicing to say, he is dead. It is finished. He worked miracles. As Sister Diane was singing that song, as Mary was recalling how he worked miracles, the hand of God was working on the earth. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and the devil and all of its imps are saying, no more miracles, no more signs, no more wonders, no more of that Jesus, no more of that troublemaker. You may remember around Christmas, I have preached a message entitled, Problem Child. No more of that problem child. No more of him wreaking havoc for us. It is finished. And so he is laying there in that grave, and the tomb is rolled to the door. You know what that tomb rolled to the door meant? It's done. It's finished. They wept. We weep when our loved ones are gone. We weep to know that we'll never see him again. Rabbi, master, he was all of those things, but now he's gone. Maybe there's some that can recall, I remember when he healed my child. I remember when he healed me, but now he's dead. The tomb is rolled to the door. He said, it's finished. What does this mean for us? Well, we continue to read in verse 62 of that same chapter. It says, now the next day that followed the day of preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate, saying, sir, we remember that deceiver said while he was yet alive, because he was dead now, after 3 days I will rise again. Command therefore that the sepulchre be made sure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away, and say unto the people, he is risen from the dead. So the last error shall be worse than the first. Pilate said unto them, you have a watch. Go your way. Make it as sure as you can. So they went and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch. So we read there in our text that they rolled a stone to the door, but they came to Pilate and said, rolling a stone to the door is not going to be good enough, because there has already been a voice and a publication from him that he is going to rise on the third day, and there's no way, we know there's no way that that can happen. That is impossible. That is impossible. How many knows that God makes impossible things possible? I know, because there's an empty grave.
The verification now is made. They said, we need to do something more. We need to do some more verification. He said, you got to watch, do whatever you need to do, seal it, do whatever you need to do to make it as strong of a fortress of death as you need it to be. So they held nothing back. They sealed the tomb, and they put a guard there to watch it. Somebody say, that wasn't enough. All verification, though, was made, and that lifeless body of Jesus was placed in the tomb. They sealed the stone. They set a watch outside of the tomb. Why? Not of fear that he would rise, but fear that the disciples would steal his body. They had no belief in the resurrection. They didn't want to even think about the possibility of resurrection. For these spiritual and religious, we'll call them more religious than spiritual, these religious leaders, some of them did not even believe. There was a debate back and forth between the Sadducees and the Pharisees of whether resurrection was even a thing or not. Oh, we don't believe that. So it wasn't about a resurrection. It's about his followers are going to do something. I wish that there would be a fear in the world today that Jesus' followers would do something. But they feared the disciples would take the body, but no man came and tried to remove that stone. He didn't need a man to remove that stone. Amy and I was talking about it on the way to church this morning. It seems like so many people today are trying to make theatrics out of church. Trying to make it all theatrics and make it bigger and make it better and the boom and the explosion and all of those things. But it says here that no man came to try and remove the stone. God don't need us to remove the stone. He's going to take care of that. So there was no room and no grounds for what they had to say of the disciples was going to come and steal that tomb. They was going to come and steal him out of that tomb. Didn't happen. It didn't happen. Says there that no man came to try and remove the stone. Not that no man was successful in his attempt. Not that no man tried their very best, but they couldn't get that sealed tomb open. Not that two or three of them couldn't overtake the guards. No man even tried. No man even tried. No man came to try and remove the stone. But listen to what happens in chapter 28, verses 1 through 6. Maybe you've already read it this morning. Maybe you've already heard it today. But in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn towards the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake. For the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come see the place where the Lord lay. Yeah, I know you seek Jesus. Another place said, why seek ye the living among the dead? He's not here. He is risen. That is not even possible. They set a seal. They set a stone to that tomb door. They set a seal upon that tomb door stone. They set a watch upon that tomb door. Everything was done. He said, do whatever you've got to do. You've got leadway and the strongest and the brightest and the most elite, however you want to label it. I guarantee you the best of the soldiers were there to watch that tomb. But all they could do when that angel came down was fall down like dead men, full of fear and agony and struggle, and did not know what to do. And they're there, and they're coming to prepare, and to bring ointment, and to bring spices, or bring whatever they came for there that day to that tomb. And that angel sitting there on the tomb door. He's sitting there not on the sealed tomb door, but imagine that door is opened up, and the angel sitting up on top of it, just sitting there waiting for them to show up and saying, I know that you're looking for Jesus, but he already told you that he wouldn't be here when you came looking for him. If you waited this long to look for him, you know he's not here. He is risen. If you don't believe it, look. look to see the place where he lays. Paul wrote this in 1 Corinthians 15 and 55. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? You know why Paul was able to write that? Because on that resurrection morn, Jesus overcame the sting of death. He gave the victory over the grave. And understanding that something took place there within the spiritual realm during that time, that Jesus, during that moment, and they thought he was dead, when they thought it was finished, they laid the lifeless body, they laid the 100% man of Jesus in that tomb, but the 100% God of Jesus was standing before Lucifer saying, give me the keys to what? Death, hell, and the grave. He had those hands, keys in his hand, not just his death, not just his death, not just his part there, not the things that he had, not just his grave, but he holds the key to all. Jesus declares this in Revelations 1 and 18. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death. That tomb door could not hold him. As sealed as it was, as much of a watch that was placed upon it, the grave could not hold him. It could not hold him. It could not keep him. Why? Because Jesus said, go ahead, destroy this temple in 3 days. We'll raise it up again. They didn't understand all of that talk. They didn't understand what he was saying, but he showed it them that day that he was risen. Now I want to take a few moments to look at us, the body of Christ, the church. Paul said that we are the body of Christ and members in particular, speaking of the church. We're his representation here now. Revelation 3 and 1 says, unto the angel of the church of Sardis write, these things saith he that hath the 7 spirits of God and the 7 stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name that thou livest. Thou hast a name that thou livest. And art dead. Jesus, he was all about life. Matter of fact, he said, I am the resurrection and the life. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life for this moment. From Good Friday to Easter Sunday, as we celebrate it and as we know it, he was dead. He said it himself. Jesus said, I am he that is alive, was dead. He had a name of life, but he was dead. For there is that moment he was dead. But now, Jesus is speaking, the Lord is speaking to the churches, and he's saying that thou has a name, that you live, but you're dead. So we look at that. We look at that statement, and we look at the church today, and we just look at some statistics of what we find about the church today. And these numbers are even worse over the last couple of years. They've been even a greater decrease in these numbers. I believe this number is even cut in half. That at the time of this survey, it was 20%. And I believe I heard not too long ago, it's as low as 10%. Less than 20% of all Americans attend church on a regular basis. So as a result of this, churches are dying in large numbers. It's a trend that keeps accelerating. According to Thomas S. Rainer of Lifeway, he said when you break the numbers down, it means that around 100 to 200 churches will close this week. That number's even elevated now. Those are old numbers. That number's doubled. Churches are closing. Pastors giving up the ministry. People are walking away from the church. During COVID, they said that during the time of COVID, that 33% left the church. 33% of the congregation have left the church. And that one-third of the church says that many of them have no desire, no indication that they're going to return. Church has a name, but it's alive. We are the body of Christ and members in particular. We're a lively hope. We profess a lively hope. We hear so many people today, you ask them, are you a Christian? Now, I've heard it a lot more with Catholics over the years, and they say, I'm a Catholic, but not a practicing Catholic. I've heard that said. But I have found there's a lot of Pentecostals, but not practicing Pentecostals. I found a lot of Baptists, not a lot of practicing Baptists. I found that there's some, you see, as Pentecostals, we believe that you can backslide, that you can go back on the Lord, and then there's some areas, and Southern Baptists and different ones believe in eternal security, meaning once I'm saved, I'm always saved, but I know some backslid Baptists. Don't matter what we believe or what we think. One Baptist man met a Pentecostal man, and the Pentecostal looked at him and said, "You're Baptist." He said, "Yes." He said, "You're the ones that preach and believe in eternal security and once saved, always saved." He said, "Yeah, that's us." He said, "You are the ones that practice it, right?" I've seen many Pentecostals that we got a name. Well, it doesn't matter what's over the door. Don't matter what's on the sign. But he said, you got a name that you're alive. The church is supposed to be alive. We've sung that song, or they sung that song. We believe for it. They say it can't be done. But they haven't seen what you can do. We've seen what he can do. No doubt if we're here this morning and we're under the sound of this preacher's voice, there's some level of belief to us. We're either professing Christians, we're either 100% in, or we've got a history with the church, there's something. We know who the Lord is. Maybe, possibly, everyone in this building this morning could quote John 3:16. Why? Because we know that we serve a risen Savior. And we know, maybe we say, well, I'm not serving him like I should be. I'm not doing everything that I should be. And when we find that not all of my desires are towards the things of God. What are we saying? We have a name that we're alive, but could that be you this morning? Whether you're here every service, or whether you're hit and miss, or whether you say, I'm saved, but you know, I just have not been fully committed, that you find that we have a name, but yet we're lacking that expression. We are lacking that expression. What does that mean, we're lacking that expression? It means that we have a name, that we're alive, but when others see us, what do they see? They may see that we're fully alive in the flesh. We're breathing. We're physical beings, obviously, but that's not what we're talking about. He says you have a name that you're alive spiritually, but I've said it this way many times, and I want to use this morning. We're dead men walking. We're going through the motions, and we're doing what's important to us, but we're lacking that expression. I saw a wonderful thing the other day. Somebody used a banana, and they had this banana. And they wanted to prove the pastor was preaching on holiness and righteousness and being a spiritual example. And that person stood up in that teaching session and said, Pastor, God just looks at the heart, and he's not worried about the outside. He's not worried about any of that. Just think about a banana. He said that a banana, it does not matter what that banana looks like on the outside. All you want to do is make sure that it's good on the inside. He said bananas can get where they look rough on the outside, but on the inside, they're still fine and they taste good. Pastor looked back at him and said, well, that's true. That may be the way that God looks at it. He said, but you, sir, when you go to buy a banana, do you reach down there and buy the ugliest banana, or do you look at that banana and look at the outside of it and see what you're looking for in your purchase? So our expression, it's not about how holy and how spiritual and how great we are, but we have a responsibility to be a light. He said, you are the light of the world. We have a name that we're alive. We have a name that we're fresh fire, fresh wind, fresh anointing. We are the church. But maybe we're here this morning. We know that we have that name that we're alive. But if we say, Pastor, if I'm honest, I'm lacking that expression. You know what that proves? It means that we're dead. We're dead. But hold on, Jesus was dead too. He overcame it. The major weapons of the enemy is death. Death also is a spiritual power. We can be abiding. There becomes a battle between spiritual powers, the power of life and the power of death. We're facing it every day. There's a power of life and a power of death going on inside of us. To be physically minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. So we can have that focus on physical things, and that's death. That battle we find ourselves in, it's an intensifying battle. And we've got to recognize that. We have to recognize that there's a battle going on inside of us. Will I be alive in the spirit, or will I be dead in the spirit and let flesh have full control? And Jesus could have done that there that day. He could have let the victory over him take place. Look back at our text, and we look back there. Because Joseph took that body of Jesus, that lifeless body of Jesus, placed him in the grave. The tomb was sealed with a stone. And nothing happened for days. Nothing. I don't know about you, but when you're waiting on something, it seems like it takes a whole lot longer. It takes a lot longer. I'm waiting for Publishing Clearing House to show up at my house with that big check. It ain't happened. Somebody said you have to subscribe to something. I thought they just showed up. I don't know. So we're waiting. The other day I was standing there. I was making some tea at the house, and I had the tea, the water boiling on the stove. And Amy walked in the kitchen. I'm just standing in the kitchen. She said, "What are you doing?" And then she heard a little bit of rumbling in the teapot that was there on the stove. She said, "Oh, you're waiting on water to boil. You know it'll take longer, right?" We're waiting. It seems like it takes. So imagine how long that time spent. Because you understand something about disciples. They walk with Jesus every day. Has anybody recently lost a loved one? And we know those first few days after they're gone. How many times have we tried to call their phone? How many times have we maybe even drove over to their house? How many times have we called out for them? Because the reality is, in our mind, they can't be gone. So can you imagine that few days there for the disciples, the emptiness they felt? We've studied this a few weeks ago talking about Peter. He didn't know what to do. They said, "Peter, what are you going to do?" "I'm going to go fishing. I don't know what else to do." Maybe some of them went fishing. Maybe some of them were in hiding because they didn't know if they were going to be next. That tomb was sealed and nothing happened for days. I get very uncomfortable when nothing's happening. I'm Pentecostal. So I get very uncomfortable when I come to church and nothing happens. When the praise team begins to sing "Believe For It" and people are staring at them like they don't have a clue what they're talking about, that gives an uneasy feeling inside of me. It makes me nervous that nothing's happening, that nothing is going on. When we don't see souls coming to the Lord, when we don't see sick bodies being healed, when there's nothing going on, when it's just silent and it's quiet, you know what happens in those moments? We begin to get uneasy, but the devil starts to get out the party streamers. He's getting ready to celebrate. And the devil loves it when there's no worship coming forth in the house of God. He loves it. Devil don't care that we show up. That don't bother him a bit. As long as we don't get engaged in the battle, in the worship. As long as we don't, Sister Amanda said, if you fasted this week and God answered any of your prayers, just give him glory. That's when the devil begins to have a problem. When we begin to glorify God for what he's done. But he's sitting back and he's watching these disciples who were following Jesus everywhere. There was no agenda. There was nobody going anywhere that day. It was quiet. It was silent. And hell began to rejoice. Why? Because the enemy thought he won. Signifying that those who are dead are separated and cut off from the living. So if the grave, Matthew Henry said, if the grave were his prison, now was the prison door locked and bolting. The rolling stone to the grave's mouth was with them. Filling up the grave is with us, completed the funeral. It was not until the stone was rolled away that the truth was revealed. He's not here. He is risen. What does that mean for us as the church? It's all about the expression. It's all about the expression. We may be in a season, we may be in a moment, we may be in a place as the church age, maybe you as an individual. We don't know you not, Paul said, that you are the body of Christ, members in particular. Know you not that you're the temple of God. So I'm talking to the church corporately, but let me tell you this morning, Pastor, who are you talking to? I just want to tell you, I'm talking to you. I'm talking to me. We have a responsibility, if we carry the name Christian, to be Christ-like, to have some expression of life in us. But there are those moments, you've been there, I've been there, maybe you're there today, that you feel like it's dead. There's nothing going on. That does not always mean that you're backslid. It does not always mean that you've walked away from God. Sometimes we find ourselves in a place that we're in a lack of expression. But the expression of his life is our testimony. What's the testify of? The fact that we are the embodiment of the things that we say we believe for, that we declare. I declare healing. I declare victory. We've themed every year, and we say we declare this a year of breakthrough. Well, year of increase. I was just looking the other day at 2017, a year of increase. And we know that it was just that. It was a year of increase. Financially, we sold property. Financially, the church grew in that year. But I saw something the other day, and I said, that's God keeping his word. And Amy said, what are you talking about? I said, 2017 was the year of increase. And I read a post that I posted on Facebook. Said within the last 2 weeks, 4 souls were saved. God's a God of his word. So when we declare increase, we just believe increase. When we declare breakthrough, we're expecting nothing less than breakthrough. If we declare I am a Christian, then we should present nothing else and nothing less than that Christ that is alive and well. He is alive. He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my life, not just in my life, but through my life. The resurrection and lordship of Jesus is bound up with the expression. It's called his testimony. And this testimony is this. It's that extra factor of truth, which is the power of life to conquer death. Talking spiritual death. The devil loves to use spiritual death. He wants you to be dead in worship. He wants you to be dead in service. He wants you to be an absentee Christian. He wants you to find, I've said it so many times, the devil cannot destroy you. He will do his best to distract you. He will do everything he can to keep your attention off the things. But when we allow that expression to come forth from our life as that extra factor of truth, and it conquers death. Paul asked this question in Romans 7:24, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? In the next verse, he answers that question, Jesus. Jesus. So I want to ask you a question this morning on this Easter Sunday. Has your Christian expression died? Jesus died. Joseph begged for the body of Jesus. He was dead for so long. I was kidding about Brother Henry last week, said he did a good job. Up in his 70s, he's died 3 times. He keeps on preaching. Brother Henry actually did die. At least twice, I know. One of the last time he preached at Hilliard Church of God, walked into the foyer after church, dropped dead. Dropped dead. Fortunately for him, there was a nurse in the congregation that resuscitated him. They got him in the ambulance, and they got him to the hospital. He died. Maybe you've been there. Not talking about that physical death, drop dead after church. But your expression, your Christian expression has died. And so not talking about that moment of drop dead, a few seconds later, somebody performed CPR and you're resuscitated. It's kind of like Lazarus,
Have you been away from the expression of the things of God so long that your loved one says, Lord, he stinketh by now? He or she has been away from church and the things of God so long, they stink. They've been dead so long that they stink. I don't want to be away from God so long that I stink. I don't want to, there's times, if we're honest, there's times that we have dead spots. You ever traveling with your cell phone, you go through dead spots, but if that thing stays dead, you throw it out the window. It's no use to me. I'm not talking about dead spots. I'm talking about dead. The enemy, so dead that the enemy rolled a stone to the door of your tomb and declared, there's nothing to worry about with this one. Was there a time in your life that when your feet hit the floor in the morning, the devil said, uh-oh, they're up? Because you was going to get in the Word. You were going to say, God, what would you have me to do today? And you was going to express, you was going to testify, you was going to tell somebody about the goodness of the Lord. But somewhere along the line, life's got so busy, and you get up in the morning, and people say, well, the devil's not even fighting me anymore. I'm doing good. When the devil's not fighting, you're not doing so good. The devil only fights against that that's a threat against him. The enemy's rolled that stone to the door and declared, I ain't got to worry about this one, meaning you don't have any expression of prayer. You don't have any expression of worship. You don't have any expression of working for the Lord. You don't have any expression of doing anything that edifies the body of Christ. Or you have a name that you live, but you're dead. And the stone has been sealed, signifying you are dead. Separated and cut off from all the living. Would you be honest this morning and say, that's me? It happened to Jesus physically. They rolled him, rolled that stone to the door of his tomb, signifying that he was dead. The world today has rolled a stone to the door, the tomb of those who profess to be the church, those that profess to be alive, those that profess to be Christians. So, yeah, I'm a Christian, but I'm not a practicing Christian. I'm going to make it to heaven someday, but I don't have time for it right now. I got a mansion waiting for me in heaven, but I don't have time to go to the Father's house here on earth. Mindsets. Maybe that's us. It's us. Or I'm there every service. I'm there worshiping. I'm there trying. But I realize that I've just been going through the motions. Dead worship. Don't even know what I'm worshiping. Don't even know what I'm seeking. I just feel dead. If you're honest, you put yourself in either one of those categories. Nobody's come to condemn today. But I just wanted to let you know, in closing this morning, if that's you, I got a reminder for you. I want to remind you of one thing that can change everything. So if you answered, that's me, to either one of those, I got a reminder for us today. As you stand with me all over this house, Romans chapter 8, verse number 11. Jesus did not stay in the tomb. That's why we're here celebrating Resurrection Morning today. That's why we're here on Easter Sunday celebrating. He's not here. He is risen. And we have testimony from Stephen as one that says, I saw him. He's at the right hand of the Father. As the heavens rolled back in Acts chapter 6 and 7. Paul wrote this for us who feel dead or are dead spiritually. In Romans 8 and 11. But if the Spirit of Him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, He that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by His Spirit that dwelleth in you. All we need is His Spirit. All we need is His Spirit. He will raise us up. Jesus looked at the sisters of Lazarus and said, "Do you believe in the resurrection?" She said, "Yes, Lord, I believe that I'll see my brother in the resurrection." He said, "No, you don't get it. I am the resurrection." So it wasn't that Jesus so much was resurrected. He is the resurrection. He can bring dead things back to life. That's what resurrection means. You need, on this resurrection morning, a resurrection. Do you need to be raised from death to life? Are you going through a dead spot? Or have you been laying in the tomb so long that the enemy just went ahead and sealed it? Say, "Man, I used to worry about them. I used to worry that they were going to be world changers. I used to be concerned that they were going to do something big for the kingdom, but I haven't heard anything from them in so long." We're just going to go ahead and roll a stone to that door. I can't help but think about Lexi this morning. Lexi went on mission trips as a teenager. Man, she was excited. She said, "Pastor Jamie, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do that for the Lord." Then she got distracted and pulled out into the world. As days passed by, more and more devils said, "Well, I ain't got to worry about her. That passion's gone." Lexi, he went ahead and rolled a stone to that door, sealed it. Said, just watch it just in case they come and try to pull her out and make her be something or do something. But then one day, resurrection came. I believe it was it Monday morning? Tuesday morning? Monday morning. God works on Monday mornings. I don't function too well on Monday mornings, but God works on Monday morning. There at her job, wasn't long, she's sending me a, she used to avoid my text. She probably got a text message she hadn't even responded to. I'd text her. Every time that song would come on the radio about "I want to go to church," I'd send it to her. I'd send a link. She'd probably look through her text message and find a bunch of those in those 2+ years that she was away from the Lord. Devil said, "I don't have to worry about her anymore." He was wrong. He was wrong. I didn't roll the stone away. Daddy didn't roll the stone away. Mama didn't roll the stone away. But when she called upon the one that raised Jesus from the dead, he quickened that was in her. That passion was quickened again. That power was quickened again. And God resurrected a backslider. Come home. She's serving the Lord. She's worshiping the Lord. That passion is coming back and looking forward to what God is going to do in her life. Maybe you're there. Maybe you're there in that same place. Once had a passion for God. The devil said, "I ain't worried about them. I haven't heard nothing about that passion, that calling, that purpose in a long time." God's wanting to resurrect that this morning. He's in the resurrecting business. That's what this is all about today, Resurrection Sunday. So if you're here today or if you're listening today, God wants to bring you out of that tomb. That tomb's door don't have a hold on you. The devil says, "I've sheared it. I've bolted it shut. You're done. You're finished. God can never use you. Your ministry is over. Your calling is finished. You can't even be a part. You can't do anything. Your reputation is gone. You've been away too long." Brother Kevin, 25 years, that's too long. Paul, 40 years of not even giving him a chance, too long. Look at him today. Why? Because God still resurrects the dead. He still brings the dead back to life. And I hope no one this morning feels like I come to church on Easter Sunday and the pastor beat me up. That's not the purpose and not the intent of my message today. But what I want us to know this morning, the devil thinks he's got you. The devil thinks that you're done. The devil thinks that God is finished with you. But you chose to get up. You chose to turn on Easter service today. You chose to listen to what God would have to say today. And God said, if you're willing to listen, I want to call you forth out of death into
new life. I want to call you out of darkness into my marvelous light. God is calling softly and tenderly. He's calling, or maybe boldly and firmly. He's calling. God's calling backsliders home this morning. God's calling someone who's ran from Him for years home this morning. He is wanting to resurrect your life. He's wanting life to spring forth. He's wanting a Pentecostal holiness, godly expression to come forth out of you again. You say, but Pastor, that's been dormant for a long time. That same Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead is wanting to quicken somebody this morning. Father, we love you today. I've delivered my heart. I shared exactly what you placed upon my heart for this service. You knew who would be here. You knew who would listen in online. You know who has a name that are alive, but they're dead. You know those that profess to be Christian, but not living very Christ-like. You know those of us that are going through dead spots. You know those of us that have been just going through the motions. God, the enemy thinks he's got the upper hand. He believes that he's got the church right where he wants it. But I believe that you're about to bring resurrection. I believe that you're going to bring a backslider home. That you're going to bring someone to the altar maybe for the very first time. Oh God, I believe that you're going to heal sick bodies. I believe for it. I believe for it, God. And I'm going to continue to believe for it. Believing, trusting, depending upon you to fulfill your will and your way in this house today. We ask it in Jesus' name. Just want to give a general altar call. I'm not going to say every head bowed, every eye closed, no one looking around. But I'm going to give a general altar call. And if you're here this morning, you're a backslider, it's time to come home. If you're here today and you don't ever have asked the Lord to be your personal Savior, today's the day for that. So I just want 100% this morning to come find you a place in this altar. If you're a backslider, or you're a sinner who's never prayed sinner's prayer and asked the Lord to come into your heart, you can do that. Maybe you're lukewarm, cold, and indifferent. You need that fire to be rekindled in your life. Maybe you need a healing, or maybe you know someone that falls in any of these categories and you want to pray for them today. Won't you come? Find you a place in this altar and pray. Seek the face of God and see what God will do in your life this morning. He's faithful. He's faithful. Won't you come today? Won't you come? Ask the Lord to move in your life. Grant it, Lord, around these altars. Move in accordance to your will and your way. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.